So actually, it's a pleasure to talk just after Patrick because there are lots of connections between his talks and mine. But they will not be obvious. But somehow, it's also integrable systems like problem, like these tilings, and also there are actually non-linear equation. There are also Hilbert transform. There are also, as you will see, eigenvalues like things which whose difference are at least one. And so there are lots of common words, but apparently it's quite different. So, but maybe after my talk, some people will be able to see the connection. Okay, so what is the problem? So typically you take a domain. So here it's an hexagon. And I put a hole inside. It's just a choice because I want to have quite a general domain. And I want to tile this domain with those edges. And so I have three different possible orientations, as you can see. And so this is one possible tiling. Okay. So, and you see that here I have horizontal lozenges and then I have these two orientations. Okay, and the question will be to try to find out when you take a domain on the mesh of the lozenge, the size of the lozenges goes to zero, what will be the global picture that you will get? So how will the tiling look like when you take it at random? Okay, so the idea is that we will take domains that we can tile. And then, very often, you have many possible tilings. And then you will take a possible a tiling at random within all these possibilities. So this is one simulation. So all the simulation I have in my talk are done by Leonid Petrov, who is very, very good to do this kind of thing. And so what you can see from this simulation is that so on the boundary of your tiling, you have very little choices. And usually the lozenges are put parallel to the boundary. But at some point, you start to have choices. And this is what we call the liquid region. Okay, this is where you have some randomness in the middle. And we would like to describe this. And so in particular, we would like to say, where do we have what we call a frozen region, and where do we have a liquid region? And in the liquid region, what can we say about the shape of the tiling? What can we say about the fluctuations of this boundary? What can we say about the lozenges in the middle? Do they fluctuate or not? So what is the global properties of this kind of tilings when the size of the mesh goes to zero? So it's an old question, and the first result was done by Cohn, Larsen, and Propp, who considered the hexagon. So it's kind of the simplest domain you can think of. And they found out that the liquid region is inside a circle, which they call the Arctic Circle. Okay, and so all this is frozen. And then there was a lot of research to try to understand what happens when the domain is changing, is more general. And there was a very nice work of Kenyon and Okunkov, who gave equations for this boundary of the frozen region. So here you have this very beautiful heart. But in fact, I think that the result also as long as the boundary of the domain is simple and kind of smooth. And then they can describe the boundary of this frozen region. Okay, and so after that, there were many other questions about fluctuations. So also, then they can describe somehow the limit shape of all the tiling. It's not only the boundary of this liquid region, but it's also the limit of the heights of the tiling. So you can see, when I speak of 8, It's maybe because I don't know. I can imagine the yellow, for instance, are horizontal, and then this is 8-1, 8-2, and so on and so forth. So you have you have the definition of 8 in your tiling, and so they could prove the convergence of this kind of object when the mesh goes to zero. Okay, and then so there was a question about the fluctuations of this surface. So okay, you have convergence, almost true convergence under very general condition to a profile, and then there was a question of the fluctuation. And so the conjecture was that somehow, if you look at the fluctuation of your surface, it will be Gaussian, and if you look at the covariance of the eights between two points, the covariance will depend logarithmically on the distance of the two points. So this is what is called the Gaussian free field, which arises in many other setup. And the conjecture is that the Gaussian, this Gaussian free field arrive in most domains as soon as it's kind of also it has a nice boundary, but it could be proven so far only in families of domains, and the work now is to try to extend it to the most general possible domains. So the first results were by Kenyon, where he considered this kind of domain where there was no frozen region, and then there was a list of work, and somehow I think in the best generality now for this result is the result I will present you, where the domains are obtained by gluing some trapezoids. Okay, so that's somehow what we are really working on, to try to generalize this result for the most general possible domains. Those are questions about fluctuations. So you can speak also, as I said, about the fluctuation of the boundary of the frozen region. That's also an interesting question. And it was proven that somehow the fluctuation, if you look at a point on this frozen region, it will fluctuate according to what is called the Tracy-Widom distribution. And so the Tracy-Widom distribution, so you take your tile, let's say your first tile here, you subtract its limit point, and you multiply by something which goes to infinity with the size, which is like n to the 2/3. And then you see that there is convergence of the distribution of this thing, and this is actually given by this Tracy-Widom distribution that I will describe later. Okay, and so again, this kind of result were first achieved for the hexagon, and then by using a Riemann-Hilbert kind of techniques by Bike, Fleischer-Bauer, McLaughlin, and Miller. And then now we can do it in more general domain that I will soon describe, which are these trapezoid gluings. And we did that with Jiao Yang Yang. Okay, and now we looked at the fluctuation of the boundary, but you could ask also about what is going on in the middle. Okay, what are the fluctuations if you look at it locally? So, and I'm not sure you can see really what. But okay, so here you have again a tiling of the hexagon. And imagine you put a magnifying glass in the middle, and you try to find out how it will look like. And so again, people can do that. And there is a convergence. So if you look at the locally, at really on the scale of the lozenges, you can see that there is a typical shape which you can observe, and which is given by the in distribution by the extended synchronal. And again, you have the same kind of question. So you have first you can do that for the hexagon, because the hexagon has a kind of the most symmetry, it's the simplest to treat. And then it was possible to do that for these more general domains that you obtain by gluing trapezoids. And very recently, there was a very nice work of Agarwal with a student at MIT who did that for all domains with simply connected, which are simply connected subsets of R2 with a nice boundary. Okay, so that's the result, and now I want to try to explain some of the ideas. So do you have any questions about the type of result I want to discuss? I put all the nice figures, and now... but I didn't put too many mathematical lines. Okay, so let me tell you a bit what kind of techniques you can use to try to address this kind of questions. The first one is a Castellane matrix. So it was proven by Castellane that if you look at the partition function for this type of tiling, so the partition function is when you sum the probability of each possible configuration. Okay, so that's a number which is renormalized in general your probability distribution, which is very important and from which you can compute most of the quantities of interest in probability. And what Castellane found is that this partition function is a Pfaffian in general. And for nice domains, it's actually better than a Pfaffian, it's a determinant. And this is very nice because once you have a determinant, you have lots of tricks to compute it. It's very difficult to estimate a Pfaffian, but to estimate a determinant, it's much easier because you have an operator that eventually you can diagonalize or things like this. So this was the first approach, which was followed by, in particular, by Kenyon and Johansson. And this also brings some nice remark that, for instance, for the hexagon, your formulas are really nice, and in fact, your distribution is what we call determinantal. So this means that you have a probability distribution which describes the position of your tiles, which depends on where the tiles interact. I mean, they have to interact because you have to think that your system is very rigid. You don't have the right, when you do your tiling, to put one tile on the other, or you don't have the right to leave holes. And so the distribution are going to be the square of a determinant. Okay, and so this is what we call in probability theory determinantal laws. And the advantage when you have a distribution where the interaction is in terms of the square of a determinant is that you can use orthogonal polynomial. Okay, because of the properties of the determinant, when you have a determinant squared, you can express the square of this determinant as a product of the orthogonal polynomials. And if you can analyze the orthogonal polynomials, then you are in business. So that's a very efficient approach when you can do it. And this was very much used both in random matrix theory and in tilings. But again, it's only in very specific cases that you can do it. So in particular, people don't know how to use it for general domains. Okay. So this is another one which is very nice and which was used quite a lot in combinatorics, and which is to see tilings as the distribution of non-intersecting paths. So what do you do? You put just a line at each level of your tile. Okay, so you have level 0, and then you put a line, then you have the horizontal tiles which are at level 1, okay, here also, then you have another path, and so on and so forth. And so this defines lines, the green lines. And then when you look at the distribution of these green lines, it will follow random walks conditioned not to intersect. Okay? And so then you can hopefully use what you can know how to do with random walks. And this is, for instance, Agarwal did to get this very nice universality result that I told you. He showed that somehow if you look at any kind of tiling locally, it will really look like this kind of non-intersecting walks. And so it could define this limit and show it's universal, whatever is the domain. Okay, but this is also one way that you can actually compute things. Another approach, which is also very powerful, is with symmetric functions. And so this, you can see that the distribution again of these tilings is very much related with symmetric distribution. So actually, in the work of Gorin and Buffetov, they showed that the analog of the Fourier transform in this situation is a Schur function. So I mean, they can really use the Schur functions as a way to compute kind of Fourier transform. And there is much more in that. I mean, it's really all the Russian school who is using this kind of approach, using symmetric functions on all its theory to analyze this kind of distributions. And of course, last but not least, there is a very strong connection between this kind of models on random matrices. And because I'm more specialist of random matrices, I will tell you about this last this last approach, okay, that I developed together with all my collaborators. So first I have to explain you the how it comes and the domains that we can consider. So the domains we can consider are obtained by gluing trapezoids. So it's a domain a bit like this, for instance. So you have a line, a vertical line. And if I cut along this line, I will have trapezoid on my right and on my left. Okay. And I want to have this kind, I can glue on any line, and I can have holes of this kind on any lines. But I have to cut it a priori only on a single vertical axis. So why do I like this kind of domains? It's because these trapezoids are particularly nice. I can exactly compute the distributions, if I look at a random tiling, of my, for instance, my vertical tiles on this given line where I glue my my domain. And the point is that if I look at this type of pattern, it's called a Gelfand-Tetzin pattern, I can compute the number of possible tiles being given this boundary condition. Okay, so that's something I'm not going to show you, but there is a way to compute exactly the number of possible tiling of this domain being given this boundary condition. And actually, you can see that this number depends on the differences of the position. So the Li is the position of the, so L1 is the position of the first tile here, L2 the second tile, and so on. So you have, let's say, n of them. Then you can see that your number of possible tilings is proportional to this guy. And then, of course, you can, if you are given a tile at random, conditionally to the position of this tile, you can compute the possible number of configuration. Okay, so you just have, if you are gluing, for instance, like this, so if I want to know the distribution of my horizontal tiles, I condition by their position, and I know the number of possible configuration is going to be proportional to lambda j minus lambda I on this side, all the product, and here I have product of the lambda j minus lambda I on this side, and on this side. Okay, I multiply all that, and I get the density of the tiles on this line. And what I can see by this formula, using this, that if I look at the distribution of this tile, it would be of the form a product of lambda I minus lambda j to some exponent. And this exponent actually is either 1 or 2. So it will be 1 when I have no interaction, for instance, between these two. Or it can be 0, actually. And it will be 2 when I have a product of lambda I minus lambda j which comes from the left and from the right. Okay? So I am just I mean, you have to think 2 minutes about it, but when you just multiply this possible number of configurations, you get something of this form. Okay, with this guy, which is ever, so it's 1, 1/2, or 0, according to the interaction between these horizontal tiles. Okay, so that's very nice because it's very explicit. You have also something that you like. So it's this Li plus 1, which has to be greater or equal to, so here it's, I put the edge, but you can remove it. Li plus 1 is greater than Li plus 1, because the tiles are separated by 1. And so I have to try to analyze the distribution of the Li given by this distribution. And the point is that this distribution is very similar to the eigenvalues of Gaussian random matrices, where you have exactly this kind of interaction, but the Li are this time real and continuous. Okay, so you can see somehow tilings, random tilings, as discrete analog of the eigenvalues of random matrices. Okay, so then we can use all our strategies to possible strategies that we develop for random matrices. But of course, it's more complicated in some cases. Ah, yes. Because I know you would not be scared by anything after lunch. I gave you some generalization of this distribution. Okay. So I put some product of functions here, which are some interaction. And this number depends on theta function, on gamma functions. The thing that you can just remember is that, so if you look at 1, you just get the square. And if you look at 1/2, you also get this. But in general, you don't have such a, it's not just a power, it's something a bit more general. But asymptotically, you always get that this interaction is going like L prime minus L to the 2 theta when L prime minus L goes to infinity. So for people in probability, you can just interpret this as particles in interaction, which are discrete, which are on some lattice. So here it's a strange lattice. You need that Li plus 1 minus Li is greater than this theta HH, which is some function. So for tiling, theta HH is always equal to 1. And you would like to analyze this kind of distribution. A special case of this is all this tiling that we are interested in. Okay, and so what we would like to do is to understand the convergence of this guy. So it's a position, so it's a profile. So this is, if you think back about the tilings, so this is the position of the ice particle. So in the interval H, so if I have a 0 like this, okay, so if I remind you this 0, I have a 1, so the L1H are living here, and the L2H are living here, L2I. So H takes 2 values. And so what we want to do is to analyze this distribution when n goes to infinity and study the fluctuations. So the Arctic boundary will come when either this measure has just no more horizontal edge, so the boundary of the support of this measure, or it will saturate. So this means that actually this ratio will be theta h. So here it will be 1. So the distance, sorry. So it means that the density, okay. So maybe I should put it here. So the question I want to understand is, what is the limit of this guy? u, uh, u h, and when mu h is zero, this means that I'm in void region. I have no horizontal tiles. And when it is equal to the saturation, which is one with tilings, then it's going to be saturated. Okay, so these bounds is due to the discrete setting, because we saw that the distance between two particles is at least theta h. So you cannot put more more horizontal tiles in a segment of size AB than B minus A, okay? Something like times N. So this explains this this type of saturation. Okay, and so what we would like to understand is the bond, the fluctuations of the extreme point in this region. This will be the analog of the extreme point in the Arctic circle. I'm totally lost. When should I stop?
We don't know.
Un quart d'heure. Un quart d'heure. 20 minutes. Une. Non, 20 minutes. Jusqu'à la demi-heure, c'est ça, oui. Un quart d'heure, 20 minutes. OK. And okay, and so once you can do that, so do this analysis in on this horizontal axis where you glue these two polygons, there is a very nice work of Buffetov and Gorin who showed how to do the fluctuation on the rest of the tiling, thanks to this beautiful Fourier transform, which is given by the Shaw function. So I will not describe that. Ah. So now what is the continuous analog, which is much more well known? So the continuous analog is just this same type of measure where you have interacting particles, but this time they're real. Okay, and the analogy with the random matrices is that if you take this potential V to be x squared, you just get the famous Gaussian ensembles, which are obtained by taking a n by n matrix, which is Hermitian, and you filled it with independent Gaussian entries. Okay, for this, in this case, so for beta equal 2, you take complex entries. For beta equal 1, you take real entries. And you can compute the joint law of the eigenvalue, and you will find this. Okay, so you, if you remember the other side, it was quite similar, except I had this kind of strange generalization by the interaction I theta. And eventually I had some weight for the tiling, which was also given by some potential. Okay, and so what can we do for this kind of particle system? So we can also look at the eigenvalues, look at the empirical measure, and see that it converges towards some profile. Okay, so in the case where you have the quadratic potential, you find the well-known semicircle law, but the limit in general depends on the potential V. And then you can also study, for instance, the central limit theorem. And the central limit theorem is much more complicated to get in random matrices because you don't have any renormalization here. Okay, so the central limit theorem is when you take the sum of any function in the lambda I minus some limit, then it will converge toward a Gaussian. And the usual central limit theorem, you have to rescale by 1 over square root of n. Okay, so this shows that there is much less fluctuation in random matrices than in independent variables. And to get this kind of result, you need much more assumption than just general mu v. What you need, for instance, is that your equilibrium measure mu v has a connected support. And so it's important to emphasize this because connected support is analogous to, if you come back to tiling, to the fact that you have a connected domain. Okay, and it has to be off-critical. And off-criticals mean that you know that the measure mu v vanishes like a square root at the boundary of its domain. And these two conditions are really necessary in the sense that you don't get the same kind of result if you don't have these assumptions. Okay. If you start to ask about the local results, it's much more complicated also to guess what you should get. So the kind of result that you would like to have is, for instance, if you look at the difference between two eigenvalues, how does it scale and what is the limit? Okay, that's the original question that Wigner asked. In this case, lambda i's were the eigenvalues of a big matrix. So they represented the level of energy of his system, and he wanted to compute the gap between two eigenvalues because it's the energy you have to put to jump from one state to the other. And you like also to study the largest eigenvalue. So again, there was a specific model, which is the which concerned the case where beta equal 2. As I said, in this case, your distribution depends on this guy square. And so you can think about this term as the determinant of this matrix. So when you have an interaction with beta equal to 2, so you have a determinant square, and this allows you to use all the theory of orthogonal polynomials. Okay. And so this was used by Mehta and Tracy and Widom to obtain this kind of limit law for either the gap or the largest eigenvalue. So how do you do? How can you do when you don't have this kind of special form, so when your system is not clearly integrable somehow? So this was done much more recently. So the question here again is, how can you guess the fluctuation of the largest eigenvalue or the eigenvalues in the bulk when you are not in the case where the interaction is with beta equal to 2? So then there was a very nice work by Dumitriou and Edelman who related so the law the law beta, so this law, this distribution with v equal to x squared, they show that this was a distribution of the eigenvalues of another matrix. Okay. And this matrix is just obtained by putting on three diagonal random variables, so which are either Gaussian or what we call chi-square. So chi-square, you can think about them as the sum of the square of Gaussian variables. And here, this depends on beta. And the reason why this was very nice to do local analysis is that you can just write what should be an eigenvector and an eigenvalue on a three-diagonal matrix, and eventually you can work on this definition because of the locality to get asymptotic results. And so this is what Ramirez and Ryder and Virag did. They used this representation to show that if you look at the largest eigenvalue in your beta ensembles, it will fluctuate according to some law, which is they call the Tracy-Widom law. And also, if you look at the spacing between two eigenvalues, then it will converge towards some law which is called the Tracy-Widom beta distribution. Again, so I presented to you this kind of laws when you have a more general potential, v instead of x squared, and you have to think that taking a general v is a bit analogous of taking a general domain in tilings. And in fact, you can see that provided your potential is kind of nice, then you will have the same kind of distribution at the limit, whatever is the potential. Okay, so let me... okay, so this is a bit... So let me apply this to this tiling. So I'm back to tilings. So you can, so in tilings, we have two different kind of models. And the most classical models is that you will fix the total height along one vertical line. So you will say the number of horizontal tile is n. Okay. And here there is a simpler assumption, which is to fix the number of tiles or of horizontal tile into each connected pieces. So then you get some convergence. And if you don't fix this, so for instance, here don't look at this, but imagine you just fix the sum of the ni, then you will converge towards some other limit law. And this type of result can be seen by a large deviation theory. Okay. So this is just for the kind of the limit of the limit law, to get the limit law. And what I want to say that you can get the fluctuations, the global fluctuations, as for the continuous case. And again, you need to have some hypothesis, okay, that I will flash quickly because I don't have much more time. But which tells you somehow it's like in the continuous case, you need to have nice off-critical potentials related to nice domains. And in this case, you can get the fluctuations of your tiles. And you can also get the fluctuations of the largest eigenvalue, for instance. And you see that it's the same type of limit. Maybe I should have just said a word. So the idea is that the fluctuations of the global statistics like this are the same as in the continuous case. And also the fluctuations of the largest eigenvalues are going to be the same as in the continuous case. Okay, so that's really the point that these discrete laws present the same type of fluctuation than in the continuous case. Is there any question? In 5 minutes, I give an idea of the proof. Maybe not. Yeah, I mean, usually that's what people do in tiling. They condition by the total height of the tiling. And then you can eventually resum if you want to look at the grand canonical ensembles.
So you have an idea of the law of the number of...
Yes. Yeah. I mean, then it depends on the model. I mean, if you look at the grand canonical, usually you will sum all of this with some gamma to the number of tiles or something like this. But the point is that normally, so maybe it's better I spend some more time. But so the idea that the number of the most natural model is that you will fix the total number of horizontal tile in all your tiling, and then the point is that if you look at the fluctuations of the number of tiles between the different connected components, it will fluctuate, but it cannot fluctuate according to a continuous Gaussian variable because it's just a discrete variable. So actually, it will fluctuate according to a kind of discrete Gaussians. And so the whole picture will fluctuate according to a GUE plus this kind of discrete Gaussian, which describes the fluctuation of the number of horizontal type per connected components. So that's somehow what is going on when you don't fix the number of horizontal tiles in each connected component. Okay, so maybe just a point on the ideas of the proofs. So both in random matrices and for this type of problem, what we do is that we get equations. So equations usually on the Stieltjes transform, because in both random matrices or in this kind of problem, Stieltjes transform are usually nicer functions than other. Okay, so it's the Stieltjes transform of my empirical measure, and I try to get equations for the moments of this kind of guy. And so usually in random matrices, we find equations which are called loop equations or Dyson-Schwinger equations. And we find them by using integration by parts. So somehow these equations are due to the symmetries of the system. And once we get this equation, so these equations are not closed a priori, but asymptotically, all the trick is to show that you can close the equation and solve them recursively when the dimension goes to infinity. So that's somehow the idea. And if you can estimate all the moments of this guy, you can prove a central limit theorem, for instance. So the point which was kind of nice is that in the discrete setting, it's very difficult to do integration by parts. I don't know if you already had this problem, but integration by parts is quite nicely in the discrete setting. And when you do that, you don't get nice equations. And then there was Nekrasov who had a beautiful idea to get a nice equation by showing that some function is analytic. And the fact that some function, some complicated function of the moment of this guy is analytic is enough actually to get the expansion on the moment of this guy. And so the idea is the same because this function is analytic because, again, of discrete integration by parts, but somehow he showed a very nice way to pull all this together. So that's for the central limit theorem. And for the local laws, what we do, so it's ideas which were developed a lot to prove universality, which is to prove rigidity. So rigidity means that we know that the system will not fluctuate much in the sense that, the tilings, we know that they are going to stay very close to their limit up to some error, which will be of order 1 over n. And so the point is to prove this kind of thing, and we can do that by estimating this T-dress transform, but this time for z, which are very close to the real axis. And once we have done that, so the idea that we can get, at least for extreme tiles, the fluctuations, because the distance between two extreme tiles will be much bigger than the mesh of the tiling. Namely, they will be at a distance of order n to the 1/3. Because they will be close to their limit, which is much bigger than the size of the tiles. And so you can approximate really the discrete measure by the continuous one. So that's somehow the idea. And I don't want to give more details. It's actually kind of painful at some point. And I think it's a good time to stop. Thank you very much.